Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining me for another restful episode of True Scary Stories to help you fall asleep. Today, we're going to be listening to our weekly compilation of True Scary Stories. I hope you enjoy them. So without further ado, lay back, relax, and enjoy these True Scary Stories.
My high school girlfriend called late one night after I was home and in bed. She said that something had happened and asked if I could come over. She was clearly shaken and not full of details, so I told my parents and drove over towards her house. At the top of her subdivision, I was met by a cop with lights on. He asked where I was going, and I told him about the call from my girlfriend. He lets me go by, and I come over the hill to the cul-de-sac where she lives, and I see multiple cop cars around the circle. They watch me pull up and get out of my car. My girlfriend comes running out of her house and meets me in the street. She explains that someone had broken into her neighbor's house and started beating her with something heavy. The neighbor managed to get out of the house and headed to my girlfriend's house, where she started banging furiously on the front door. My girlfriend's dad was out of town, so her mom answered the door, and the neighbor just fell into the foyer, bleeding profusely from the head. Her mom looks up to see the attacker headed up the walkway towards the front door. She pulls the neighbor into the house and closes the door, hitting the attacker with it before it fully closed. He then took the heavy tool that he had used to beat the neighbor and smashed the little window at the top of the door. Her mom started screaming, and the attacker just turned around and walked up the street into the darkness. I spent the night there that night, along with two or three cops outside in their cars. And in the morning, we could still see the blood pooled on the floor in the foyer and splattered blood above the front door from where the attacker had swung the bloody tool to smash the window. No one was ever caught or even identified. It was just completely random. The neighbor survived, and to my knowledge, had no permanent physical injuries beyond scarring from having her scalp stapled shut. She moved away shortly after the incident. This story kind of creeps me out even to this day, but I have a pretty good one. I lived in Mesa, Arizona when I was 10 years old. We lived in a rough area, but I was just a kid, completely ignorant to the dangers of the world. I was walking back home from my friend's house, and my mother wanted me home by 9, and I'd always start walking back at around 8:40 to make sure that I wasn't late. And it's only a couple of blocks from my house, so it wasn't a super long distance. It was around the time of the year when the sun would set at 5:30, and it would be dark well before 7 p.m., so it was very much nighttime. As I'm walking, I hear a woman calling my name. I turn to look and see that it was one of my mom's friends, but she didn't know her too well. However, I just saw that she was familiar and won't say a name, but I turned around and said hello and smiled. She walked up to me and told me my mom had called her and asked her to come get me and ride me back because something happened at my house. She said that it was an emergency and that I needed to go with her and her husband, whom my family was also familiar with. I was only about 5 minutes from my house, but I was told that it was an emergency and I agreed to go with her. As I'm walking, I get this weird feeling in my gut and this shaking in my legs that I now today realize was my instincts being on high alert. I stopped for a minute and asked if we could call my mom, and she said that my mother was in the hospital right now and that I needed to hurry. Right as we were opening the door to her car, I hear my mother shout my name as loud as she can, and I turn on a dime quickly and I walk towards my mom. My mom asked what was going on, and the woman replies and says that she was giving me a ride home because she saw me. That was not the story that she gave me, so I told my mother what she told me and asked what was going on. My mom just looked at me, and she could always tell when I'm lying versus when I was telling the truth. The woman then goes to interrupt me, likely to lie, and my mom cuts her off and just stared back at her with the most shocked look ever, and these words still send shivers down my spine. She says in the most shocked voice ever, "You are trying to take my son." And the husband looks out the window, hurrying his wife in the car. And as I look back towards them, I can see a syringe on the dashboard leaning against the windshield that he grabs right as I see it. She gets in the car, because at that point my mom was ready to kill her, and reached into her purse because she keeps a pocket knife. But they drove away, and right after they did, my mom looked at me and just burst into tears saying, "I almost lost you." My mom knew full well what was happening, and I was still too shaken to even say anything, and just hugged her back and we went home. I was still in denial, and to cope, I would convince myself that maybe I wasn't in any danger. My family, of course, never kept in contact with any of them, but my stepdad at the time submitted a tip to the police of the incident. When they caught up with him about 3 months later, we had found out that he was arrested for having CP on his computer and found restraints in his closet, as well as some containers of propofol. They found pictures of me from my mom's Facebook, downloaded on his computer as well, leading them to believe that I was actually being watched for a good bit. I never liked talking about it because to this day, if I hadn't stopped for those 10 seconds to ask the woman to call my mom, I don't know where I'd be, or if I'd even be alive right now making this comment. And while it may seem like something that would have been easily forgotten, it was never the case for me. I haven't even told my closest friends this story, but I might sometime soon. I asked my mom what happened that night, why she came looking for me. She described the same feeling that I remembered feeling moments before I was almost abducted, just a lot sooner than I did, and just had the instinct that I was in danger. I'm not usually a lucky person. It seems the odds are always against me, but I always remember how lucky I was that night, that my mom decided to listen to her instincts when I didn't. I've never ignored my instincts since, and every night after that, when I finally did decide to leave my house, my mom would walk with me all the way up until I turned 13 to come back to live with my dad. And that, to date, is the scariest thing I think I've ever experienced. It's some stuff you only hear of on the news, and nobody ever assumed that it'll happen to them. But my life was a mere 20 seconds from being completely different. Up to this day, I'm still looking for a logical explanation to this. This happened in 2003. So I and an ex were checked in a coastal resort where the cottages were far apart, like 200 meters away. At around 11 or 11:30 p.m., while we're both drinking beer with the lights turned off and only the TV on, the doorknob suddenly rattled violently, like someone was forcibly trying to get it open. There was no double lock on the door, so my first reaction was to jump from the bed and block the door with my weight. The force of my landing must have been heard from the other side, but the twisting of the doorknob continued. By this time, I was already pressing my face to the floor, trying to look and estimate how many people were outside the door via the small gap between the floor and the bottom of the door. There was nothing, not one pair of feet or anything, but the doorknob just kept rattling. I should point out that the gap between the floor and the door was enough for me to see the outside, or at the very least notice any change in shadow or light caused by movement. But there was nothing. The turning of the doorknob then stopped, but I never heard any footsteps or any other noise. I waited a few minutes and then opened the door. Everything was quiet. No footprints outside or on the sand surrounding the cottage. We just noped out of there immediately. The previous story is something very similar to something that happened to me in Indonesia. Only, it was a glass sliding door every side bungalow. Outside sunken bath, a couple of meters of clearance around it in a path. I'd got up really early, 3 a.m., to see the sunrise at the volcano some distance away through jungle and road. I had got back early, maybe 10 a.m. I was so tired I lay on the bed in my shorts, curtains open on every side, and just fell asleep. I was awoken by this absolutely insane banging on the glass sliding doors. Bear in mind, I could see all around through the glass, but for like the four wooden posts at the corners. But there was nothing there. I jumped. I mean, that's a really mild description for what I did, and stood in the middle of the single space, just looking for where it was coming from. And I could see the windows shaking as they banged. It was proper fast, too. Not a regular banging, but bang, 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 bang. Just this uninterrupted salvo of something that I couldn't see hitting the window so hard that the glass was moving. And then it started going around the cabin, banging as it went. Like I say, I could see it bending the glass as it did, though it was hard to track at first, just because it was so weird and fast. I darted over to the bedside and called reception, shouting for them to come down. This was a threaded pathway away from the main hotel and its old Dutch colonial building. And they came. It stopped after a few minutes. I waited, still standing. They arrived. And when I told them what it was, the porters and butlers, yeah, it was quite a posh hotel thing, just crouched down and put their hands on their heads and began crying. A couple of them hightailed it right off the car and didn't come back to work. One of them, a lovely guy called Kenang, told me a bunch of stuff about the villagers who had been angry that these cabins had been put up. Apparently, only half of them, cabins 1 through 6, had been built. But he always gets calls on the switchboard from cabin 12, which is yet unconstructed. And when he picks it up, it's just a jumbled hiss and voices. When I was 17, I was hanging out with two friends and they wanted to go smoke weed in the woods. I didn't feel like it, so I drove them and waited in the car. After a while, I was getting bored and decided to go meet them. But there were four paths going off in different directions, so I just took the biggest one. After walking for a few minutes in the pitch black forest, before flashlights on phones, I come across this dip in the trail, and on the other side is a bench lightly visible due to the moonlight. On the bench is sitting a man, and another one is standing in front of him, but I can only make out their silhouette. Being sure these are my friends, I yell out to them before walking over. If you ever walk the woods at night, it's just an uneasy feeling all around, so I was cautious to begin with. Well, it turns out, just after yelling out to my quote-unquote friends, both silhouettes turn around towards me. Not a word, not a sound. The guy sitting down starts sprinting at full speed towards me in complete silence. I got the absolute crap out of there, sprinting also the other way, and tripping over stuff because I couldn't see anything. I finally get out and lock myself in my car, but I was really worried for my friends. Maybe a minute later, I see them both coming out of a completely different path. They also confirmed that they never saw me or anyone else. My heart still sinks, thinking about that dude sprinting in silence. Like, what was he going to do?
Years ago, I remember sneaking out of my friend's house at night to really do nothing but walk around the neighborhood and hide from car headlights. We were young and bored. There was a homeless camp that was down in some woods off the railroad tracks, not too far from his house. We had seen the trail and knew what was back there. One of the homeless guys that lived there was actually an old friend of my buddy's dad, and he had stopped over a few times, and my friend's dad let him shower there and everything. He could have worked if he wanted, but legit told us that he just liked living off the grid. Just wanted to give you some backstory on the reason why we thought it would be cool and safe to go check it out at night. We were a bit nervous at first, thinking what if we get there and his dad's friend isn't there? So we were sneaking up on it. It was a longer walk than we thought. We got kind of close and saw there was a fire going, lighting up the woods a bit. We start sneaking closer, but the trail seemed to continue straight, while the camp set off the trail to the left. We got, I don't know, maybe around 100 feet from the camp, and we looked down the trail and saw a faint silhouette of what we thought was a person. The silhouette looked like it was coming from deeper in the woods towards the camp. We froze and ducked slightly to the side of the trail. I told my friend that I didn't like it, and we should just sneak out. He said he had the same feeling. As I said, the fire at the camp was going just enough to light the area well enough to see. We end up slowly creeping slightly off the trail, back to the railroad tracks. We get probably 30 or 40 or so feet, and I told him that I would rather just hit the trail and slowly walk back, because the bushes and trees and everything were hard to navigate, and I would rather be able to see something coming so we could book it out. We played football, and we're both pretty fast. We slid out of the brush, and see the silhouette has gotten closer. However, moving further from the fire, the light was dimmer, but we could still make out someone or something was standing there moving closer. My first thought was that maybe they saw us duck into the bushes, and were coming to check, but it just felt off. My friend and I looked at each other, and both mutually and silently decided to pick up the pace. Almost on cue, we both looked back, and the silhouette was now booking it towards us, absolutely silently. No noise, just fast movement. We hightail it out of there as fast as we can. Thankfully, the trail was wide, so we weren't bumping into each other or anything. Neither of us looked back until we hit the railroad tracks, then hit the railroad track bridge, and we're on the other side. I looked back as I was slowing down, past the bridge, and didn't see anyone. We got back to his house pretty fast, and luckily, that was the end of it. I think I suppressed this story until now, and I can't remember exactly where it happened, but an ex and I went for a romantic weekend out of Jakarta somewhere, a mountain resort surrounded by rice paddies and tea plantations, if I remember correctly. It was beautiful and expensive. I was woken up at probably 3 a.m. in the pitch black in our room by some banging on an internal door, and then I heard it slide open. In that split second, I thought it was my ex who couldn't see anything, trying to go to the bathroom. Then she sat up and screamed beside me. I crapped myself. I got up, turned all the lights on. The sliding door that we had locked was unlocked and wide open. I thought initially that someone had broken in and we'd startled them, but the outside door was still locked. We noped out immediately as well. We managed to find some other weird reports online, but there wasn't much, and this was back in 2008. We never got an explanation,
only thing I can think of is that someone may have gotten in via a manhole or something, though I never waited around to bother and look. I refuse to believe in supernatural stuff, so it's the only logical thing that I could consider. As I say, I've clearly suppressed it until now. Yeah, Indonesia is no joke. I had an experience there as well. I stayed at one of the biggest hotels in Surakarta. Our room was directly in front of the prayer room. I found it odd that unlike other places where prayers were recited only during prayer times, the verses were ongoing on a loop throughout a day and continued on even at night. I started to get suspicious when we heard things crawling in the ceiling and the air conditioner turning on and off on its own. But hey, these can always be explained by faulty wiring or critters in the ceiling. Although whatever it was sounded much too large for the plaster ceiling. It got worse when it got somewhat rhythmic with the noises in the ceiling, like it was timing its movements with the verses. But whatever, I was tired and decided to just sleep. I woke up at 3 a.m. to see a wispy, shadowy creature hunched over the table with its back to me, eating. When we checked out, I delved deeper into the Google reviews. Half the reviews made reference to spooky things and encounters in the hotel. I was out in California with my wife and daughter. She was about 10 months old at the time, visiting my father-in-law. We drove into the city to hang out. He had to handle a traffic ticket, so we drove to the courthouse. As we drive in, this car is driving into the lot. There was a gate with a guard. Not driving super fast, but too fast for a parking lot. The attendant seemed to be running after the car. We were super confused. The car proceeds to drive into the lot, pick up even more speed. Then the passenger, a woman, opens the door and falls out of the car. We stop our car. We're not in the lot yet, and we were all wondering what the heck is going on. The car stops. The driver hops out and starts chasing the woman. Then all heck breaks loose. She's screaming. He's chasing her. The lot attendant is close behind him. And then I notice the driver chasing her has a knife. The woman passenger runs towards the courthouse, up the steps, and the driver chasing her catches up. Courthouse police are running towards them now. Three of them, guns drawn, yelling at them to stop. The driver tackles the woman. Remember, he has a knife. And as they tussle on the ground, we hear 4 to 5 gunshots. I could have sworn they just killed both of them, but the woman jumps up and is quickly ushered into the courthouse by one of the cops. The other two approach the man, guns still drawn, and he writhes around a bit and then goes still. My wife didn't think they were real gunshots. She thought that they were beanbags or something. Thankfully, my daughter was in a rear-facing car seat and had no idea what was going on. We turned around and left. The news later reported the woman was being physically abused by the man, but she convinced him to take her to the courthouse to deal with a speeding ticket or something. She took her chance to get away. He chased her with a knife, and the courthouse cops shot and killed him. I was crazy impressed that they fired into this tangle of two people, and the woman wasn't injured. Still doesn't feel totally real that I watched those cops shoot and kill that guy. My friend was asleep in her bed when the window next to her was broken open by a burglar. She ran out the door while the burglar was climbing through her window, but he cut himself on the broken glass of the window. He then proceeded to bleed all over her apartment and pass out in her hallway, He died from blood loss in her doorway because the glass cut his femoral artery. The ambulance came and took him away, but he was already deceased by that point. She sent me pictures of her walls and bedroom, and there's just blood everywhere. So basically, my friend had someone die in her apartment in the middle of the night, randomly, and cover her place in blood. She then had to call hazmat cleanup to clean the place, and she moved to Canada shortly thereafter. My girl and I were flying into her hometown after being out perusing around the country for Thanksgiving. It was a few days earlier than scheduled, so we didn't tell any of her family, or mine, who also flew in, because we had been spending Thanksgiving together for the last few years. We honestly didn't utter a word. This was back in 1992, so there were no cell phones and no tracking abilities or any of that. Anyways, we got into town late at night, around 11 p.m. or 12 a.m. We had decided that we were going to stay in a hotel, since the plan was to surprise the family, and while showing up at their doorstep late at night would have certainly surprised them, that wasn't really the kind that we were going for. We get into our room. It's got a kitchenette, a couch, a TV, a king-size bed. It's all around probably one of the nicer places that we've stayed in. I pass out immediately. She takes a shower. From what she's told me, she lays in bed, unable to sleep until about 2 a.m. For context, we were in an extended stay hotel with a door that led right out into the parking lot. There was a sliding glass door to the left of the bed. Straight ahead was the couch, the door, a desk, and a smaller window. Blinds were shut on the sliding glass door, but on the smaller window, I guess they were open a crack. But when she realized she was too tired, she didn't care all that much. Our room was completely dark, so it wasn't really like anybody could see in any kind of mentality. As she turns over to go to sleep at 2 a.m., through the slightly open blinds at the smaller window, she sees a flash, like a camera flash. But because the parking lot is 50 steps away, she just simply assumes that it's a street light and doesn't think anything of it and falls asleep. 5 a.m. rolls around, and I'm woken up to loud knocking on the sliding glass door. She wakes up only a few seconds after I do, and is just as confused and disoriented as I am. Continuous, persistent knocking. I had half a mind to just assume that it was some drunkard. It was the holidays after all, who had come back from a night out and made a wrong turn somewhere while trying to get back to his room, but was sure that he was where he was supposed to be. Knocking stops briefly, then starts on the front door. I want to further emphasize how this knocking was. Not quite a police knock, but someone was sure that they wanted into this room and wasn't going to stop until they got in. I go over to the door to look through the peephole, and I don't see anybody. The knocking starts again on the sliding glass door. If it was someone trying to wake up whoever they were with because they got locked out of their room, wouldn't they be announcing themselves? Wouldn't they be calling out the name of the person that they were trying so desperately to wake up? Like I said, the knock wasn't quite police, so I know that it wasn't them. They would have made sure that everyone knew they were there had it been. I go back to the sliding glass door and stand there. The knocking persists. Once it stops, I peel the curtain back just enough that I can see out the window. I'm pretty blind without contacts and didn't have my glasses on, so I'm practically pressing my face up to the glass to see who I can see. And I see nobody. The second that I shut the blinds, the knocking starts again. At this point, I'm freaked out. I was trying to keep my composure as to not make my girl unsettled, but we're both already past that point. Nobody knows that we're here. Nobody that would want to pull a prank on us. None of our family, our friends, nobody. The only person that knows we're here was the older man who checked us in. And why the heck would he care where we are? I'm borderline a little worried for our safety. If whoever was out there managed to get in and had cruel intentions upon entering, I'm a small guy. I'm 5'8" and 125 pounds soaking wet. I can talk a lot of crap and can throw a punch. But if somebody bigger than I really wants to kick my butt, they'll be able to do it no problem. I call up to the front desk as the knocking doesn't stop. And on the second ring, the man who checked us in answers and seemed concerned as to why I'm calling at this hour. I explain the situation. The knocking is still happening as I'm on the phone. And he tells me that he's going to send a security guard over to check it out. The knocking continues on for about another minute. Not even probably 2 or 3 minutes after the knocking stops, I get a call back from the front desk who says that security didn't see anybody. Didn't see any signs of anybody, but that he apologizes for whatever happened. Super comforting. Neither one of us fell back asleep until it was light out, and when we went out later in the day, there was a singular footprint leading away from the sliding glass door. Weird, because we were in a nice part of town. It was a place that she grew up in and therefore felt safe in, knowing the area as well as she did. That's one of the reasons we chose to stay at this place. It was horrible. We are both still stumped as to what the situation was. I don't know. I still get uncomfortable just thinking about it. Really. This is a story my mom tells me all the time. When I wasn't even 6 months old, my dad was out of town on a work trip, and my mom was home alone with me and my older brother. The house was kind of isolated and had a gravel driveway with one of those doorbell things where it would ring the doorbell whenever someone drove or walked close enough to the garage. At 11:30 p.m., my mom hears the chime and wakes up. She knows that my dad isn't due home for 2 more days, so she's positive that it isn't him. She grabs a shotgun and sets in the hallway that leads to the front door. Someone jiggles the handle, and my mom makes a point to loudly pump the shotgun and tells the person that she's aiming it at the door. Then she heard the chime go off again and hears them running down the driveway. That was it. The next day, she heard sirens whiz past the house towards the neighbor's place. They'd been found stabbed to death in their bed. The police assumed that the murderer had either come by my house either before or after they'd killed our neighbors. My mom's friend's friend went on a Tinder date with a dude and they met at a lunch place, and things were going great. After the date, the guy asks if she wanted to have coffee at his place, and the date had been going great, so she said yes. They go to his place, and as soon as they are inside his apartment, he closes the door and locks it, and turns to her and says, "You're not leaving this apartment alive." She freaks out and quickly ran to the closest door. She got lucky, and it's the toilet. As soon as she had locked the door, she sends her location to all of her contacts and tells them to call the emergency number for our country. Then she calls the police. The police arrive, and the dude has almost completely hacked the bathroom door to pieces with an axe. She is still inside, completely terrified and panicked. Once the police get the dude under control, they sent in an EMT to calm her down and get her out. When they take her out from the bathroom, the police tell her not to look to her left, but of course she had to look. The whole apartment, from ceiling to floor and walls, were covered in thick plastic, and there were a bunch of tools on the floor. He had it planned meticulously, and she got incredibly lucky to be leaving alive. This is going to be a somewhat long and controversial story, but it happened to me. I was driving home from visiting a friend who lives several hours away from me, 6 hours to be exact. I hadn't seen my friend in a very long time, and instead of leaving early from my visit, like I should have, I left their place at like 8 p.m. I messaged my husband when I left and told him not to wait up for me, as I wouldn't be home until almost 3 a.m. We said goodnight, and he told me to drive safely. The highways that I would take to get home aren't major thoroughfares. I live in rural Canada, so 90% of my drive would be on small two-lane highways. It's actually a beautiful drive through gorgeous countryside. So I'm into my drive about 4 hours when things get weird. I'm literally in the middle of nowhere when my GPS starts acting up. After about 5 minutes, the thing literally just dies on me. No problem though, I'll just use my phone. No sooner did I load the directions on my phone and it starts acting up. The screen flashing on and off, the coordinates started spinning, really weird stuff. Then, just like the GPS, it just died. Still not a huge deal. I'm only a couple of hours from home. I can find my way. So I turn on the radio. I had been listening to music on my phone, but it died. Normally, at this distance from the city, you can still pick up a station or two. But nothing. Just this really weird static. It was the most beautiful, calm, clear summer night. And the stars were so vivid when you're out of the city. But literally, out of nowhere, this weird green fog started to appear. As I continued driving, the fog got thicker, to the point where I'm only driving like 40 kilometers per hour on a highway that I was literally doing 120 on. Then, literally out of nowhere, my car died while driving. I drove as standard, so I just threw it in neutral to coast as far as possible. When I finally came to a complete stop, the fog was so thick that it was actually in the car. I could barely see my hands on the steering wheel, and it had a terrible taste. Next thing I know, it's daylight out, and I'm being yelled at by two CN workers. I was still in a daze. It was almost like I was frozen. The workers are screaming at me. I guess my car is parked on private railroad property. They ask how I got past security with my car, why I'm there. I couldn't answer. I literally had no idea where I was. They told me to get out before they call the cops and file trespassing charges. I tried to explain what happened. I told them that the car died on the side of the highway. I went to start my car to show them that it was dead, and after some heavy hesitation, it finally started. I couldn't believe where I was. I was literally inside of a CN rail yard. How did I get here? There was a 9-foot fence surrounding the compound and a locked security gate at the front. I asked the worker where I was, and when he told me, I was in disbelief. I was at least 100 kilometers from where I last remembered. As I'm driving out, I instantly remembered my husband. He must be worried sick. What time is it even? How the heck did I get here? My phone was still completely dead, so I couldn't message him. When I finally got home, it was 3 p.m. I tried to explain what happened to my husband, and he was in total disbelief. We both were. The next day, I went to the phone store to see if my phone could be fixed. They said it might take a week or so, but it was repairable. The very next day, I noticed something was wrong. I felt like crap. My hair seemed to be falling out, and I started to get a really bad rash. So we went to the hospital. I told the hospital what happened to me a couple days earlier, and they thought that I was joking. It wasn't until my blood work came back an hour later that they took me seriously. I had radiation poisoning. They immediately put me in an isolated room. I spent a total of 21 days in the hospital before I was deemed non-radioactive. And when I got my phone back from the cell phone company, the last time my GPS pinged, it said I was 4,000 feet in the air. I don't know, but I think I may have been abducted. I was 17, taking the metro from the suburbs to Chicago at 8 p.m. alone. So this was like 2011. I was reading my book and heard a loud sound behind me. I turned around, and a man, about 40, was looking at me with his bag on the ground in front of him. He picked it up and sat next to me, blocking me from exiting and sort of pushing me into the window. I was alone in the car except for the conductor, who left within a few minutes. The man began talking to me, saying that when I turned around, I was more beautiful than he thought I'd be. He said we could have a life together, but it'd be hard, since people would talk about our age difference. I said I wasn't interested. As we pulled into the station, he grabbed my arm hard and said, "Don't scream, I have a weapon." He was walking me off the train into the crowd, holding my arm. Behind me, I heard the conductor shout after me, "Miss, you forgot your book." And the man let go of me and ran away. I ran to the conductor and was crying. He said he thought the man was my father and had no idea. I was on my way to catch another bus, so I just sort of numbly ran off, looking in every direction until I was on my next bus. I never told my parents, because I didn't want them to not let me travel to see my boyfriend at the time, now my husband. Anyways, don't sit in the empty train car. I used to sleepwalk when I was a child. We lived in a rough neighborhood, Decatur, Georgia, and I would wake up outside in the middle of the night, not knowing how I got there, and would have to walk home and walk into the darkened doorway I had left wide open for whoever might be lurking around. However, the time that scared me the most was when I was about 9 years old. I woke up and found myself with the bedroom curtains drawn, back, and staring out the window. As I came awake, I noticed a very large and completely hairless man, no hair, eyebrows, etc., staring at me, and slowly inching closer to the window and closer to my face. He was looking bewildered, like he wasn't sure what he was seeing. At that moment, I realized what was going on and started screaming uncontrollably, frozen in place and peeing down my leg. The man freaked out and screamed, did a tumbling move, and then ran off in a weird zigzag like he was trying to dodge bullets. My mom woke up and thought I probably had a nightmare. The next morning, we found a screwdriver on the front porch and damage to the door jamb and door handle. I still just about pee my pants when I tell that story, but now it's usually from laughing. I will never forget the look on his face when I started coming to life and screaming, or his high-pitched scream and his duck and roll, dodging and bobbing all the way down the street. I was active duty in the Navy, served aboard a submarine. We were in port one day. Most of the crew had left. The guys on duty for the night were given permission to bring our kids on board for dinner. Halfway through the meal, someone makes an 4MC announcement. 4MC is the emergency announcement intercom thing. Says there's light smoke in the engine room, quickly followed by fire in the engine room. We train for this stuff religiously, so everyone is immediately in action. The commanding officer is still there, but topside. One of our senior enlisted guys apparently ran the kids up front to a hatch where he was quite literally throwing them through the hatch as our CO caught them and sat them on the deck topside. The rest of us ran toward the fire, and I see no one grabbing a mask, not one person. So I grab a big handful of breathing masks and follow through the hatch where we're greeted by what appeared to be light smoke filling the entire engine room. But it didn't smell like smoke. It was sweet, and tasted sweet. An oil pump had blown and filled the entire back half of the boat with atomized hydraulic fluid. A guy was moments from lighting a torch in the engine room, as the casualty was called. Had it been called just a moment later, we'd have walked into an inferno. Had he, for some reason, not heard it called and lit the torch after we had run in, we'd have been on fire before we could react. It all turned out perfectly fine. Cleaned the oil that clung to the surfaces and fixed the pump. But it was somewhat surreal, understanding just how close we were to a wildly different result. I was with a guy for a couple of years when I realized that he'd taken up smoking meth as a hobby after work. We had numerous problems already, and I had 3 small kids, so I finally kicked him out. A few days later, maybe a week, he makes a fake Facebook page and sends me a friend request. The only posts on the page were talking about killing me and my children, his self-unaliving, and how he planned to do it that day. The most recent post was accompanied by a selfie of him in my backyard. A recent selfie, so he had been there. I was on my way home with the kids late in the evening when I got the request. I had stopped by my parents' home the day before and gotten my dad's 9mm handgun because he was sending messages through mutual friends about burning my house down. I called the police as soon as I got home, and they didn't seem to think it was a big deal and didn't have an officer available to come check my house before we walked into it. I live in the middle of the woods, and we have a rinky-dink police force. Anyway, I made the kids stay in the car. I gave my oldest instructions on what to do if anything happened, and I had to sweep my own home in the dark with a 9mm just in case he was in there waiting for me and my children. And it was terrifying. I had to check my entire house every time we came home for a while, and I was always worried that I'd eventually find him there. Police were called numerous times, and I was eventually granted a restraining order a couple of weeks later, when the death threats continued. He died about a year ago, and all I felt was relief. In the early to mid-90s in Northern Ireland, I was a kid of around 8 or 9. The sun was shining and it was sometime in the early afternoon. My dad needed to return a library book in the Crumlin Road, a Protestant loyalist area in Belfast. We were Catholics, and the Crumlin Road was notoriously dangerous at the time, still is to a lesser extent. So I was already a little on edge, just knowing the reputation of the place. My dad was cool though, didn't seem worried or anything. It's not like we have Catholic printed on our foreheads. He did say, however, that I had to pretend to have a different name if anyone asked me. My name is one which marks you as a Catholic, so I adopted a Protestant name for the trip. We came to a road which led to an intersection, across which was a predominantly Catholic Republican enclave called the Ardoyne Road. We were headed to the right, down a long, winding path, but further up the road ahead, towards the intersection, we could see a group of men. One of them was running back and forth across the road, relaying information between 2 pockets of people. Some were staring across the road towards the Catholic area. Some were talking to a man in a parked but running car. One in particular stuck out. He had long hair and a leather jacket and was very tall, at least compared to the other men. It all looked suspicious even to me as a child, although I didn't know why. But my dad's demeanor changed to a more serious and quiet one, and I took it as confirmation that we weren't safe. He was from Belfast. We were living in a town outside of Belfast at the time, and grew up when things were at their worst here, so he knew the ropes and knew the signs that something was happening. We weren't walking towards the men, so it wasn't a problem. We crossed to the right and started walking away. This is when a woman approached us. She was middle-aged with short red hair. She saw us coming and made a purposeful beeline towards us. She seemed preoccupied, nervous. She started grilling my dad immediately, asking who he was and where he was coming from. She was talking in a, "I'm trying my best to sound casual, but I'm failing" manner. I could feel my entire body beginning to boil with fear.
and I felt as though I was mere moments away from being discovered. It was like a horror movie where someone finds themselves in a small town where everyone is in a cult or something, and they're trying to blend in but are drawing suspicion and are losing themselves in an ever-increasing paranoia. I suddenly had visions of my dad getting shot and me screaming over his corpse, maybe even getting shot myself despite being a child. The longer my dad and the woman talked, the more I was starting to lose the ability to hear, as though my head was underwater. I was holding my dad's hand, and I was struggling to keep a grip because of the sweat pumping out of my palm. I didn't know how or why, but something primal in me recognized that we were in serious danger. It was clear that she was a part of whatever was going on around the corner, and was trying to manage and analyze the flow of foot traffic, especially that of strangers like us. Given that she and us were the only people on the street, she had been doing a good job. She was fishing hard for information about us. My dad played it cool and responded to her questions without really revealing much, doing a much better job of being casual than she was. The area we were from, he explained, was mixed, i.e. Protestant and Catholic, and he feigned displeasure at that fact, trying to signal that he hated Catholics and was somewhat miffed to have to live amongst them, without ever actually using those words. It was subtle, and I was terrified that I might need to participate in the conversation, because there's no way I could dance around the truth, as well as my dad was doing. He explained that he was just here to return a book, which he showed her as proof. She asked about me, my name, and I gave her the fake name. She surely read the terror in my face and could hear it in my voice. My dad decided that that was the time to break off and say, "Nice to meet you, all the best," and started walking away with me. I could sense that the woman didn't budge and just stood and stared at us as we walked away. I glanced over my shoulder after about 30 seconds and just caught a glimpse of her turning and walking towards the road where the men were gathered. We rounded a corner and were now at the top of a very long and steep road path with the library at the very bottom of it. The path was fenced on one side, and on the other side was a row of houses. It felt like we were walking deeper into danger, and that we had only two routes of escape: keep going or turn back the way we came. About partway down the road, we realized we were being followed. My dad told me to run ahead and check that the library was opened, and I hesitated. He said it was okay and to just go and check. I glanced over my shoulder. It was the man in the leather jacket with the long hair. I did what my dad wanted and ran ahead, heart pounding and ears pricked, awaiting the crack of gunfire. I checked the door was opened, and I ran back up. As I was coming back, I saw that the man in the leather jacket had turned and was making his way back up the road. My dad looked unfazed, but was walking with a certain rigidity, like something had happened in the time it took me to run to the library and back again, and he hadn't quite unclenched his fists yet. He said it was okay and we were safe. I asked about the man following us. He said he sent me ahead, and when I was a safe distance away, he stopped and turned around to face him, ready for whatever happened. He said he was expecting violence, but as he turned around, the leather jacket dude immediately put his head down, turned, and walked back the way he came. My dad watched him for a few seconds, and then started making his way back towards me. That afternoon, within the hour we were there, a Catholic taxi driver was murdered in that street. The vibes that something terrible was going to happen were justified, and I've never felt as terrified as I did that day. When the news about the taxi driver was on TV that night, I knew I had seen the planning of a murder, and I knew we had walked into the middle of it. I could probably have identified both the woman and the leather jacket man had I been asked about them by the police, but that was never going to happen. No way my dad would have volunteered himself, and therefore me, to the cops, to be a witness against a terrorist cell.
Something weird happened to me. It was more scary in a what could have been kind of way.
so not on the same scale as some of the other people in the comments. I was a 17-year-old and I'm male, and I was walking home from a nightclub, quite drunk and stoned at about 2 a.m. I'm in a lonely part of my walk. No people and very few cars. Just a road and some large shops. A barbecue and a carpet showroom. Out-of-town shopping complexes that have since become ubiquitous in the UK. Anyway, in a lay-by, about 15 feet away, is a car pulled up with lights on. As I stumble past, two men step out and call me over. Something about the situation immediately sobers me up. I keep walking, and one of them shouts, "It's fine, we're the police. We'll drive you home." I stop for a moment and reply with a smart comment along the lines of how police would never do this and that they were dodgy. Calling them dodgy always sticks in my mind. He insists that I'm too drunk and it's not safe for a young man like me, and I should let them take me home. I say no, and he then calls me to come over here and listen to the police radio in the car to prove that they are real police. It's weird the guy is almost begging me, desperation in his voice. I repeat a firm no, tell them I'm fine and keep walking. The minute I'm out of sight, I run as fast as I can and don't relax until the 30 minutes later that I'm home. I can only assume that they didn't manhandle me into the car because there was the very occasional taxi passing by. I'm 45 now, and occasionally think about how that could have ended for me. None of the scenarios seem good. Sadly, stories like this are probably more routine for women, but at the time, it really shook me up. I was around 10 years old. I was at school, but my mom told me that she was thinking of taking me to the doctors in the afternoon. I had a recurring eye issue. It was lunchtime, and I'm in the dining hall when the office woman told me there was a taxi outside for me and that I needed to go. I assumed that my mom booked it for me, as she can't drive. I cleared up my stuff and got my bag. I was just about to leave when I remembered my jacket in my classroom. I rush to get it and head out for the taxi. The office woman tells me that I'm too late and the taxi had gone without me. I just went back to class, but I was panicking that my mom would be angry at me. School finishes and my mom is waiting for me at the gates. I burst into tears, apologizing for missing the taxi and thinking that I was in big trouble. She never ordered a taxi and had no clue what I was thinking about. She ended up not making the doctor appointment. No one ever found out who ordered the taxi or who the driver was. My mom doesn't like to think what would have happened if I hadn't forgotten my jacket and got in that taxi. When I was about 18, my friend and I went to the movies and decided to walk home. It was a bit of a walk, but we didn't want to pay for a cab. I'm always pretty vigilant when walking, especially at night, so I noticed a guy with his hood up walking behind us. Every so often, I'd look over my shoulder and check on him. He started pretty far behind us, but was gaining ground weirdly quickly. The last time I turned my head, I caught him sprinting at us. I panic and tell my friend to run for it. She's in those Birkenstock slip-on sandals that were popular back then, and she's struggling to run, so I'm dragging her until we get to the gas station. I bang on the window and beg the clerk to let us in, but he says he can't because it's past a certain time at night. But he promises if the guy comes near us that he'll call the cops. The guy comes down the hill, through the gas station, staring at us the entire time. I swear, the only reason that he thought better of it was because the gas clerk had the phone visibly in his hand. Plus, he was a big guy. I completely broke down after he left.
Just the thought that he was running at us while I had my back turned scares the heck out of me. What if I didn't turn? When I did, that last time. I was camping with my family and our family friends. The parents get toasted during the night, and my friend, her cousin, and I get to camp out in a tent while everyone else is in campers. After the parents are passed out and the fires died off, we're just talking and slowly calming down for sleep. It was probably around midnight or so. We hear the crunch of some shoes on gravel and the jingle of a collar on a leash. A soft shadow of a tall man stops by the side of our tent, facing closest to the gravel road. We are all stone silent, and a man's soft voice says, "Hey there, girlies." We say nothing, in the stillest silence I've ever experienced. "What are you girls up to so late?" Silence. We're looking at each other with wide eyes, thinking we're essentially on our own, because the campers, while being close by, are filled with our smaller siblings and our intoxicated, snoring parents. He hums something to himself, like he's mulling something over, and then his shadow moves, and he continues on down the road. Was he probably just some drunk guy walking his dog? Likely. But was that the scariest experience of my young life, and the first time that I realized that in a situation like that, I didn't have the right instinct? Yes, it was. 2 hours later, the cousin had to use the bathroom, and by then we'd calmed down a little bit. But it was the most paranoid sprinting to the outhouses up the road that I'd ever had. I'm a guy, and when I was 19, I was at a friend's apartment one night for a party. Things were starting to wrap up. It was very late, and we were all standing around in the parking lot, talking as we got ready to leave. Then this beat-up old Ford Bronco pulls into the lot, and a tall, lanky guy in Western garb, hat, boots, belt buckle, gets out. That in itself wasn't unusual. I'm in New Mexico, and you see people dressed like that all the time. But instead of going into an apartment, he walks up to our group and just stands there. Never says a word. He wasn't acting in a threatening way. It was just really weird and awkward. So we all decide this would be a good time to leave. We got in our cars. He got in his Bronco and we all drove off. When I got onto the street, he pulled out right behind me, which I didn't think too much of at first. But then he revved his engine, pulled right up on my tail, and flipped on his high beams and a light bar. Now I knew something was up. At the time, I was driving a little 1985 Dodge Omni that could maybe do 75 if you dropped it off a cliff. So there was no way in heck that I was going to outrun a V8 Ford Bronco, even if I was crazy enough to try. This guy could easily keep up with me. I didn't know what to do. In retrospect, I probably should have driven to a police station, but that never occurred to me. And even if it did, I don't know if I would have known where the nearest police station was. This was the early 90s, no smartphones or Google Maps. So I did the only thing that I could think of. I swerved onto a side street into a poorly lit residential neighborhood. He followed me. But I had a bit of a head start, so I gunned it and turned off my lights. I just sort of randomly drove around the neighborhood for a while, until even I couldn't remember what route I had taken, and I couldn't see him in the mirror anymore. When I was pretty confident that I had lost him, I found my way to a main road, turned my lights back on, and headed home. To this day, I don't know if I was the victim of a stupid, drunken prank, or if I was nearly murdered. My younger sister had a similar experience when I was 12. It was Halloween, and my mom had taken us trick-or-treating around our street. When we got back home, we asked if we could stay out a bit longer riding our bikes. We lived in a cul-de-sac, so it was normally only neighbors and their visitors driving by. After a short ride around, just as we had stopped in our driveway, a car stopped, and a man told us, "Get in the car." My sister and I froze out of fear and didn't respond. He repeated the demand before driving away. I guess he was worried an adult would see or come outside. We rushed inside, locked the garage behind us. The police were called and came to our house to take the details. We even spotted a car that looked very similar after the incident at the nearby shops, and my mom informed the police. A few months later, we came to find out that the man who approached us had been arrested for luring a young child away and assaulting the child during Christmas carols at a local botanical park, which my family and I had also attended. I remember being shocked and disturbed when I first found out about the assault, and even more so when I realized that what could have happened to me or my sister that Halloween night, when we found out that it was the same man that was responsible. My mom always told me to not approach or talk to strangers. One day when I was walking home from elementary school from the bus stop, which was around the corner and down a block, an older man drove up to me. I was on the right side of the road, and he was driving towards me and parked next to me. So he was on the wrong side of the road in a residential neighborhood. He had a map in his hand and asked me if I could tell him where this street was, as he pointed at the map. I took a couple of steps towards the car and remembered the lesson that my mom had taught me and stopped and asked, "What street is it?" He told me the name of the street, and I gave him verbal directions and started walking again. Something didn't seem right to me though, and I don't get why he needed a map to ask where a street was that was not difficult to find. I was literally a few miles down the main road, a block away. I just figured he wanted to kidnap me. This happened when I was little, around 6 or 7. I was being watched by the neighbors across the street with her 4-year-old and newborn. The mom decided we should have a picnic on the driveway, but after a little while, she had to go inside to get something, maybe to use the bathroom. I can't really remember. But as soon as she left, this old couple rolls up to the driveway and asks me and the 4-year-old for directions. I tried to tell her the street was a few streets over, but she said that she couldn't hear me over the car, so could we come closer? I wasn't sure what to do, because I already knew about stranger danger but didn't want to be rude to elders. Luckily, right then, the neighbor's mom came sprinting out and talked to them. I overheard the lady say that I was helpful, telling them that they were on the wrong street, and the neighbor told her the same thing I did. It was only when I was older, thinking back on it, that I realized that it was weird that they asked such a small child for directions, and that she had heard what I said, but lied, trying to get me to come closer. Definitely, probably, would have been kidnapped. Back in Sweden, I was casually walking back from an after-school club, probably around 7 to 8 years old. I can't remember for certain. Autumn weather, rainy and dark. A car pulls up next to me, drives slowly. A relatively old man looks me dead in the eye. I look straight ahead. I start walking a bit faster and he speeds up. Instinctively, I turn around and frantically start running towards the main road. It's about a 30-minute walk from school to my house. Anyway, as I run along the main road, one of our neighbors see my reflective dangly bit, stops and offers me a ride back home. It shook me up for weeks after, but my parents didn't care. I was in Walmart with my dad, probably around 6 years old, and I had just walked to the door while he was checking out. I was an impatient child and had trouble simply waiting for any length of time. A young boy, I suspected maybe a year or two older than me, approached. I was too young to be terribly suspicious, so I went along with it when he struck up conversation. He eventually asked if I was here with someone, and I said that my dad was just over there. He then forcefully grabbed my wrist and told me to come with him, trying to ultimately pull me towards the door. I was thankfully able to free myself, and I ran away. Shortly thereafter, my dad came up and we left. It could have been nothing, just some kid being stupid. But with all the stories of kids being kidnapped in traffic, it's terrifying to consider what could have happened. I remember when I was 11, I was walking across the road to grab some candy with my friend. We lived in townhouses and were neighbors. So this happened right in front of our building. This pasty bald ginger dude comes up to us as we're waiting at the light and says to me, "You're my older sister's name, sister, right? Want to make $1,000? All you have to do is take a few pictures." I managed to choke out a no while turning to my friend, who's equally terrified, her eyes on the light waiting for it to change. As soon as the light switched, we bolted to the store and hung out there for a little bit. Broad daylight, busy arterial road for the city. 5 minutes later, it was like it never happened. Around August of 1978, I was in my late teens hitchhiking from Illinois to Michigan. I caught a ride on Route 94 outside of Chicago with a middle-aged man in a pickup truck. He was a nice enough guy, friendly and talkative. A half hour or so into the ride, I happened to glance at his crotch and noticed that he had his zipper open with his junk on full display. Not good. I stayed calm and waited until we got near an exit and asked him nicely to pull off. I told him I was getting car sick. He ignored me and blew past the exit. Crap. There was another exit a few miles ahead. I told him I was nauseous and was going to vomit and to please take the next exit. He blew past that one too, and I instantly recognized the danger that I was in. I knew I had to get out of the truck. All I could do was bluff. I'd seen it once in a movie. I reached into my backpack and pretended to grab something and hold it in my hand inside the backpack. I told him that it was in his best interest to drop me off. I told him that if he didn't drop me off, I would use the thing in my hand and that would be very bad for both of us. It worked. He must have figured I wasn't worth the trouble. He took the next exit and dropped me off at a gas station. Fast forward to several months later when I picked up a newspaper and saw a picture of the man who had picked me up hitchhiking on the front page. He had been arrested, suspected in the murders of multiple young men. That is the creepiest face I've ever seen, and I never hitchhike again. I've had a few, but due to my age at the time, this one sticks out. I was 20 and heading back to my car from buying groceries. This weird guy in this van beside me starts leaning out of his driver's side window and starts asking me about the books in my back seat. You must be in college. I saw the books. I remember taking those classes. I hate causing a scene, so I just said, yeah, I just started not too long ago. I try and get to my car, but he's leaning half out the window to get as close to me as he possibly can. I'm trying to get around him, but there's nowhere to go without having to walk by him. He then sees my t-shirt and starts talking about the band on it. He likes this band. It's really cool, etc., etc. I say thanks for the chat, but I really must be going. He says something about knowing which school I go to and that he likes my bumper stickers. They really stand out. I finally finagle myself around him, get to my car and drive off. He follows me for a bit, so I just drive in random circles in the area until he disappears. That messed with me for a little bit. My neighbor at the time told me next time to get his description and his license plate. There's been a creep in the area making attempted kidnappings that they're trying to catch. Thankfully, I was overweight, so he'd have a hard time wrangling me. This could only happen to one of my friends, who is one of the sweetest people that I've ever met. Where we live, there's a suburb that has all the nightclubs and some tech businesses, but still has a large homeless presence. So over the years, it's developed a bad reputation. One night, my friend is heading towards a gig and takes a shortcut through a dark alley, where out of nowhere, an Aboriginal guy asks him for a cigarette. My friend, being the nice guy he is, rolls him one and just starts having a conversation with the bloke. An Aboriginal woman approaches my friend from behind and puts her hands on his shoulders, but doesn't say anything. The guy my friend is talking to nods like he's saying no, so the girl just leaves. My friend says he has to go, which the Aboriginal guy replies, you know, I was actually going to R-word you, but you turned out to be a nice guy, so I decided I wouldn't. My mate just legged it. When I was 10 years old, I was watching television in the living room around 11 to 12 noon. The door was open, and suddenly, a guy with somewhat long and curly hair, and really tall too, stands right at our door. I asked him, "Do you need anything, sir? Are you looking for my mom?" He didn't say anything. He just stared at me and shook his head a little. I keep asking. He stayed silent. My brother, who was 11 or 12 years old, is in the living room too, so I go to our kitchen where my mom is doing something. "Mom, there's a guy at our door," I said to her. When my mom turned her head towards me, she got startled. I turned around to see the guy standing right behind me, and I didn't even hear his footsteps. Mom then started yelling things like, "Who are you?" and other stuff that I couldn't remember. My brother was standing frozen in the living room. Our neighbor's house is just beside our house, so my mother runs towards the exit at the kitchen and shouts for help. The guy leaves before our neighbors arrive. He was fast, and he wasn't even running. My neighbor, who was probably 20 plus years old at the time, even tried looking for him and tried to scan the streets, but no one saw him. That was the creepiest guy I've ever encountered. I was pumping gas while driving home after a round of golf with friends. I wasn't particularly aware of my surroundings because I'd been to this gas station many times. All of a sudden, and out of nowhere, a middle-aged man asked if I know where the church is from the pump across the aisle. Puzzled because there are so many churches in this area, I asked for clarification. He then starts asking me with increasing angst if I accept Jesus and whether I know Jesus. My hair is standing on end at this point, so I start babbling about how I love Jesus. Then he says, come on over here and let me show you something. Then I finally get a good look at this situation. This crazy person is driving a 1980s to 1990s faux wood station wagon with curtains all around the rear windows. I had a car with a V8 at the time, so when the guy turned around, I threw the gas handle on the hook, jumped in my car, and got out as quickly as I could. I took a circuitous route home at fairly high speed just in case. So I'm pretty sure he was either going to help me meet Jesus that day or show off the body of someone who already did. Either way, not a good situation to be in. My sister and I were playing outside when we were younger, and an elderly couple was walking by our yard. Our yard had a cemetery in the back, so it was quite a common local attraction for tourists, as this house was built in the 1800s, and most of the graves were from children who died back then from the flu, etc. There were some creepy stories from that place, but nothing lives up to what happened all those years ago. As we were playing outside, this couple kept pestering my sister about what her name was as they approached us and got closer. We were just little kids and got terribly scared and ran inside and told our mom what had happened. The following week, I heard a story on the news about an elderly couple approaching a teenage girl, kidnapping her and R-wording her. And it was the same couple that had approached my sister and I. I still get creeped out about that. In college, one of my friends, Matt, really wanted this cheap IKEA cabinet thing for his gamer setup that someone was advertising in one of the campus apartments near his place. We were going somewhere with our other mutual friend, Chris, and he swung by to get the cabinet on the way there. We get to the apartment, and the guys go in and I'm in the car. They come back out after viewing the cabinet and brought the seller with them. My friends were clearing out the trunk, and the seller was hanging around my window trying to talk to me. He was really weird, so I was just giving one-worded answers. He kept asking if I wanted to come upstairs to see his fish tank. No. And I politely declined several times. He had these shifty black eyes that creeped me out. Like, I'm sure his eyes were brown, but they were super dark and beady. I'm pretty sure he might have been tweaking off of something. Then he kept showing off his sinewy arms and bragging about weightlifting. Dude looked like a shaved bird, so I don't know why he thought I'd believe that he regularly lifted 300 pounds or whatever. They all eventually go back inside to get the cabinet, and a while later I see Chris holding the door to the apartment building open and waiting for Matt and the seller to bring it downstairs. All of a sudden, I see Chris freak out and run inside. I got out of the car and ran over. Matt was at the bottom of the stairs with the cabinet on his leg. It was lightweight, so at best, the fall hurt him the most. The seller was standing in the middle of the stairs nonchalantly. We were fussing over our friend when the seller realized that the appropriate human emotion he should be displaying was concern. It was creepy seeing him just stand there all blank-faced, and then having this light bulb moment like, "All right, look concerned, say something nice." The seller was like, "Oh no, are you okay?" Matt said that he was fine, and then him and Chris just took the cabinet outside and put it in the car. I was picking up a piece of the cabinet that broke off on the stairs, when the creepy guy basically teleported behind me and stroked my arm. He said that I absolutely super totally needed to see his fish tank collection now. And I said, "No sir, goodbye." Matt didn't mention being shoved until later, but I was obviously already getting sketchy vibes from the seller, so I fully believe him. Apparently, they were both holding the cabinet and going down the stairs. Matt was walking backwards down the stairs, while Weirdo Guy was at the other end. Matt swears to this day that the man looked at him in the eye and shoved the cabinet into his chest and watched him fall backwards with it. He said that the shove happened after the seller asked if he partied, and Matt said not really. He refers to him as the party pusher and thinks the story is hilarious in hindsight. I still think it's terrifying. When I was a kid, my dad owned a houseboat and a speedboat. My big brother and I would spend a good chunk of our summers with him. Anyways, this was in Southern California, and there were all these waterways with tiny islands in them. There was a party going on one, and my dad took us. It was more of an adult party, and I was only 12, so I just wandered off and did my own thing, played in the water and whatever. There was a tiny peninsula next to the docks, which was serving as additional parking. I went to go get some ice cream from the guy selling it out of a cart and was walking back when I heard someone calling out. I look over and see a dude in a boat, probably in his mid-30s, calling and waving to me. I kind of watched him for a second because I was often wrong about these things. I thought that maybe he meant it for someone else. But no, he was waving me over and trying to get me to come onto his boat. A 12-year-old girl, who looked 12 at the most. By the time I had fetched my dad and my brother to confront the guy, he was gone. Wish I had maybe hustled more. I have very little doubts as to what would have happened to me had I gotten onto the boat. Anyways, this was also around the time, unbeknownst to me at the time, that they had pulled a mummified lady out of an old refrigerator. Scary things happened in that area. I was 8 or 9 years old, I think, and we had a little field, mostly just sand, on the opposite side of the street where I played a lot. One day I was sitting there with a friend, building some sandcastles or whatever, and suddenly an old guy came towards us. I have to say that this street was on a hill, and very quiet most of the time, since it was only used by our neighbors and other people that lived there, rarely some joggers or people with their dogs. He asked us if we would know the way to an old playground that he used to visit as a child somewhere in the area. There was no playground anywhere near my street. So we tried to explain to him that there's no playground here, but he insisted that it was there, somewhere, and asked us to join him so that we could find it together. I don't know why, but my friend was being very friendly to him, while I was thinking about running over to my mom as soon as I could tell her. And then she said yes. So he actually grabbed her hand and started walking with her towards another street that was also next to the field. I tried to stop her multiple times while she was getting up, and he was starting to get very sassy towards me, almost mocking me because I wouldn't get to see the great playground and that I'm a horrible friend. When they were starting to walk away, I immediately jumped up, ran over, which he had seen, and told my mom, who then called the cops. We both ran out again trying to find my friend. After a short while, we saw her approaching us, alone, from the street that they both went to. She seemed very confused. She then told us that after a short distance, he said that he had to go in a bush for a few seconds and then didn't come back. Me and my mom were crying and hugging her while she still didn't really understand what the problem was there. The police came but didn't find anyone, so we described him and they wrote it down, but he never came back or was seen by any one of our neighbors. I still get goosebumps thinking about what could have happened. This actually happened to me, so I'm going to be a little vague for the sake of privacy. I've never wanted to give much of a crap about things, so I used to give hitchhikers and strangers rides if it looked like they could use it. One day, I'm in my driveway washing my car before I leave for class at college, and I see a sketchy-looking guy walking down my street. I don't live in the best neighborhood, and there are several bad neighborhoods pretty close by, so being wary isn't unwarranted. He's wearing weird clothes. They look like cheap, badly cleaned dress clothes. A white button-up shirt, sleeves unbuttoned, black wrinkled slacks, and a scuffed, old, battered black briefcase. He had a shaved head and looked scrawny, like he had been starving somewhere. When he got nearby, he asked if I could give him a lift, and I got a weird vibe from him, but I said sure. I asked where he needed to go, and he said somewhere vague and told me that he would give me the directions and it wasn't far. Asked me if I would stop at a local liquor store. I do, and he gets a beer and some cigarettes, and offers me both, but I decline. Then take him to his destination. On the way there, he explains that today was his first day out of jail, after having served 3 years. I didn't know what to say, so I congratulated him, and he thanked me and swigged on his beer. Destination was a well-known hangout for gang members, right on the edge of an especially bad neighborhood. I pull in and drop him off, and he thanks me and leaves. Now, about 5 years later, I see him again. Same guy, impossible to mistake him. He still looked the same, only like he had been fed better, less scrawny. He was on the witness stand at a murder trial, a murder that took place at the very place that I dropped him off about 3 weeks later. Chances are good that he stayed there from the time that I dropped him off and never left. He testified against the people who did the murder. They were gang members, part of a gang that he was a member of before he went to jail. He's lived in hiding since the trial. The person murdered would have been a member of my family through marriage if he hadn't been murdered. He was the only person to testify against them. I had goosebumps during the entire trial, the day that he testified. When I was around 18, one of my friends lived in a house about 3 miles outside of the village that my friends and I lived in. It was right next to a motorway / freeway and had a large amount of land attached to it. His parents ran a horse stable in one of the attached fields. His parents had gone on holiday, and we were planning on having a small party at his house, about 20 to 30 people. A few of us met up at the village and walked through the country roads up to his house, which took about 30 minutes. When we got there, we found 2 police cars parked in the drive. We all thought that the party had started, and for whatever reason, the cops had gotten called. Turns out that the friend who lived there had been eating dinner, waiting for people to turn up, when he noticed someone standing at the bottom of the garden, just out of range of the porch light, watching him. Thinking that it was just one of us messing with him, he slipped out the side door in an attempt to get behind whoever it was and surprise them instead. After sneaking around and not being able to find the person, he headed back expecting us to be there, waiting only to look through the kitchen window and see an unknown man sitting in his kitchen, finishing the dinner that he had been eating. Apparently he looked dirty, unkempt, and basically like a tramp. My friend noped out, ran a mile to his nearest neighbor and called the police. When they turned up, they searched the house and property with dogs, but couldn't find anyone. It seriously freaked him out. Several of us ended up staying at his for a week until his parents got back. I'm sure I'll sound crazy, but I'm super creeped out from a recent interaction at a grocery store. I was shopping with my toddler, and an older lady, maybe 70-ish, who was by herself just came up and said, "Ma'am, do you know all the canned veggies are in sale for 50 cents this week?" And went on about how it's a great deal and they don't run it often. I said, "Thanks, I appreciate the heads up, and I'll definitely grab a few on my way out." Then she begins to walk away, and it's almost out of sight when she stopped and looked back and smiled at my son. She then asked how old he was. I said, oh, just over a year. She then asked if he was my only child and some other random questions about him. Then she goes, hey, I just remembered. I have some clothes in my trunk, all boy stuff in the 2T to 3T range, and asked if I wanted it. I politely declined. I said we'll be shopping a while and I didn't want to hold her up. She then proceeds to say, oh, not a problem. I'll just wait outside and then I can come back and find you before you leave. Are you a single mom? Would you need them? I got this gut feeling that something was off about this lady and I just said, nope, not a single mom. And we have all the clothes that we need, and then thanked her for the offer. She tried a few more times, saying things like, I just don't know what to do with them. If you could use them, I'd be happy to give them all to you. At this point, it really felt like she was trying to lure me and my son to her car. I continued to decline the offer and then walked away. I did a few more laps around the store looking for things that I needed, and at one point, I saw her standing in an aisle in the center of the store with a younger man just people watching. I could just be super paranoid, and she was just a sweet old lady trying to be nice. But something in my head just told me to get out of the conversation as quickly as possible. I feel like parents will know that having a small child makes strangers talk to you all the time and want to make small talk about your sweet kiddos. But this conversation did not feel the same as the others I've had while out with my son. Has anyone had a similar experience? Two years ago, I lived near a big city while taking care of my great-grandma. One day, me and my mom decided to get some groceries, but we didn't have a car, so we had to walk. When we were almost to the local King Supers, I heard my first name being shouted. I ignored it at first, thinking I was hearing things, but then this random lady, who looked pretty disheveled and scared, ran up to me and grabbed my arms and kept repeating my name. My name is not a common name, and everyone that I know calls me by a completely unrelated nickname. So there was no way she heard someone else say my name. She looked so frightened, and I will never be able to get her face out of my mind. She was holding onto my arms with this really tight grip, and I remember being surprised because she was very skinny and frail looking. Her grip left bruises on my arms for a while. My mom ended up grabbing my arm and dragging me away. She was freaked out too, but didn't say anything. She just kept praying. When I got home, she prayed a lot and blessed me. I was not scared of her, just more confused. How did she know my name? And why did she look so scared? When I was 13, I was at the Goodwill with my mom. We went to pay for our items, and there was an older man at the cash register. He gave me a weird look that made me uncomfortable. Just as he's finished ringing up everything, and when my mom was momentarily distracted by paying, he looks at me and quietly says, "Smile." And even though I was confused and creeped out, I smiled, and in an instant he retrieved a Polaroid camera from under the register and took a photo. Then, just as quickly as he took it, he put it out back under the counter. My mom noticed the flash and the confused look on my face, but the cashier acted as if nothing happened. It happened so fast and was so weird, we just looked at him in shock and left. When we got to the car, my mom asked, did he just take a picture of you? And I just nodded my head. We didn't know what to think, so we just kind of tried to forget about it. Still creeps me out thinking that this man probably has my photo and who knows how many other people's photos. So when some stranger says smile, just don't. This happened a few days ago, whilst I was on my way home from visiting my friend's house. I was driving on a back road late at night in my Tesla Model 3 while it was on auto drive. I'll admit that I was not paying attention to the road, and I was on my phone while I had my music in the car playing. The ride was okay and chill for a while, but I'm not really sure because I was not paying attention at the time. Out of nowhere, my car immediately braked and made an alarming sound. I was scared and immediately took control of the wheel and looked through the windshield. When I looked, I saw a figure standing inches from my car, barely avoiding being hit. My heart was racing for the impact, and now seeing what I could only assume to be a person. They didn't even flinch from the sight of almost being hit. I looked at them for a good 10 seconds before I put my car in park and turned on the megaphone to ask them if they're okay. They didn't respond and proceeded to walk near my window. I locked my doors while they're approaching because I was terrified. They asked me if I could roll the window down to speak to them, but I refused and told them that I could hear them from the other side. I then asked why they're out here all alone in the cold, and they told me that their car had broken down and that they were hoping that someone would stop to help them. As they were talking, I got a good look at their face, and they appeared to be 25 to 30. They also asked me my name, and I told them that my name was Rebecca. They told me their name was Ashton. After that small talk they attempted, I told them that I would be calling someone to come assist them with their situation. They weren't happy with that, and instead asked that I drop them off to a friend's house who lived nearby. That's when I become really freaked out and suspicious. They had told me that they were waiting for someone, and now they need to be dropped off. I put my car back into drive and told them again, from the window since megaphone is not available in park, that I would call someone to come help them. They then tried to reach for the door handle, but I guess they forgot that Tesla handles are embedded into the car. When they did that, I immediately stepped on the pedal and went flying down the road. I didn't even look into my rearview mirror or put the car back into autopilot. The whole ride back, I was scared. I got back onto a main road where I would hope to see cars and just floored at home. I couldn't get my mind off of it for the rest of the night. I have suspicions that the guy was not alone and that there was other people with them. I pray that they didn't get someone else who wasn't as lucky as me. I will never in my life stop to help some random person ever again. I was in a different city for placement. I was going inside Morrison's, and the security guy at the front was saying hi to everyone, and he was sometimes saying bonjour. The old man started speaking in French with him, and I said bonjour back to the security guy. The old man heard, then asked me if I could speak French, and I said yes. He started asking me some questions like, "What's your name?" and "What are you doing in this city?" Stupid as I am, I gave him my real name and said that I was here for placement in this hospital. We said bye to each other and didn't think about it anymore. This happened on a Wednesday. I went back to the hospital on Tuesday. My supervisor came and gave me a letter. The letter had my name and what I do in the hospital. I opened it, and it was a letter from the old man. By the way, when I say old, I mean old. He looked older than my granddad. The old man was saying that he had a good conversation and wanted to meet up with me to have a drink, and it was his number and email address. I was a bit freaked out to go back to Morrison's from that day, and from that day I tend to give fake names to strangers. I thank God he wasn't like a mad person, because he basically knew where to find me if he wanted to. So guys, don't be stupid like me, and never give your name and what you do or where you work or live to strangers. Stay safe, everyone. Just after 1 a.m., I was sitting in my living room watching Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs, browsing Reddit. The most boring Saturday night ever. and then someone's knocking. I live with my brother, and there's a guy who visits him sometimes, so I assumed it was him and just opened the door. But there was this random man in his 40s, looking kind of sus, saying, "Sorry, I'm so sorry. I'm looking for a taxi place." So I said town center, and he keeps apologizing, asking if he woke the kids. He's also very close to my door. I don't have any kids, but I said yes, hoping that he'd leave. I was scared that if I tried to close the door, he'd pushed in. I got so anxious, I started shaking. And he goes about that taxi again and says, "Can I ask you a question? I got divorced yesterday. You're beautiful." And a car was coming up, so I said thanks. You know, I tried to be polite so he wouldn't get angry and aggressive. And I shut the door and I just stood by the window to make sure that he was gone. Jesus, how was I so stupid? It could have ended badly, especially that I live in a really crappy area and my brother wears headphones all the time. Why was he asking about kids? To see if I was alone? And he went in the direction the car was coming, so I don't know if it was a random car or someone picking him up. I don't know if he was a thief or just drunk, and I had the lights on, so he knocked. I really hope it's just that. I really hope that I start thinking before doing anything else. Also, I wish I could get a gun. It's just not an option where I live. Also, it was nice to get it off my chest, even though y'all did not make me feel any safer. Thank you for the kind comments and tips. I'm a female, and this story took place when I was 12. It's more than half my lifespan ago, but I still get really uneasy when thinking back to it. I tried to block it from my mind and guess as to what could have happened if not for two kind strangers. I was walking home from school one day. It's a 4-kilometer walk along a busy road. I was walking alone, however. At one of the intersections I crossed, there was a tall, dirty-looking man that noticed me. I would guess his age was early 30s. Being a kid back then, I struggled telling the age of the adults. He started following me and trying to strike up a conversation. He kept telling me that I was beautiful and that he wants us to be friends. He asked me where I live and if my parents would be home. He asked me so many questions, but I tried to just shrug him off and be polite. I didn't answer any of his questions, just increased the pace at which I walked. When we were nearing the block on which I live, I started becoming really uneasy. He wanted to follow me home and I did not want him to. He gave off a weird vibe because adults did not usually speak to me that way. The only way I could get rid of him would be to give him my cell phone number and agree to answer when he calls. Because this situation made me uncomfortable, I gave him a fake number and hightailed it out of there. A few months passed without me running into that man again. So I completely put this out of my mind. He was probably just some random weirdo. However, as you can guess from here, things did not stay that way. One day, approximately 4 months later, I found myself walking home after school again. I will admit that I wasn't paying much attention to my surroundings. That was until I heard what sounded like footsteps running up behind me. I reflexively turned to look around. And it was that same creepy man that I had encountered before. He slowed his pace as he reached me, but was yelling the entire time. He figured out that I had given him the wrong number, and he was furious. He kept yelling and yelling that I think that I'm better than him. That is why I gave him a fake number. I was terrified in that moment, as he was very angry. I was afraid that he was going to hurt me, but couldn't grab the attention of any motorists. I speed walked to the closest petrol station, which was luckily not too far, with him following behind me, still yelling the entire time. When I got to the petrol station, I immediately got the attention of two burly men standing next to their pickup truck. They must have seen the terrified look on my face, plus the man following me, as they immediately ran over to ask if I was all right. I was too scared to speak, just shook my head frantically as I tried to get behind them.
They immediately demanded to know why the man was following me. He fed them some crap line about being my brother. I just silently kept shaking my head. I guess they figured out what was happening at this point, as they started yelling at the man, accusing him of something. I didn't stay to find out. I took the opportunity of him being distracted to start running away. The man noticed that I was leaving and tried to take off after me. The burly men really took offense to this, as they immediately tackled him and threw him in the back of their pickup. He was screaming at this point. They sped off with the guy at an inconceivable speed right past me and just kept going. I was happy that they took him away, but I did not stop running until I reached home. I had no idea what to make of this entire exchange, but it really shook me. I do not know where they took the creepy guy or what they did with him after. In all honesty, I don't want to know. I told my parents and altered the route that I walked home from school. I never saw him again, and I'm thankful for that. Even though I could not say what I needed in the moment, those two kind strangers saw that I was in distress and dealt with it for me. Even after all these years, I still remember the sheer terror and then relief when they took him away. Thank you so much for listening to all of the stories in this video. I hope you enjoyed them. I also hope that you enjoy the extra rain at the end. Get a good night's sleep, everyone, and I'll read to you in the next video. Bye-bye now.